I think it was just when I got to Warwick.
I think
I
was chairman, and Ryan Sanderson, my colleague, was co-worker, was running a library. And we faced another one of these huge rounds of cuts because publishers had put the prices up far more than inflation. And we decided that it was time somebody did something about it. And we would set up an electronic journal that would be essentially free, we thought. And it's gone on from there. I mean, this is the thing that has made it. I would say this is Geometry and Topology. Geometry and Topology is now the world's top specialist journal. We're ahead of Topology. We're ahead of well, anything a differential journal, anything that isn't the whole of mathematics. We're ahead of now. This is as based on impact factor. And the reason how we managed to get so good was because we just decided that we weren't going to found an electronic journal, we're just going to found a journal, and we'd go for the best editorial board we could. There's our editorial board now. I mean, it probably doesn't mean a lot to you, but there are three or four Fields medalists there. Mm. The most important thing is that it's the whole of the world we've chosen from. We haven't just decided we're doing a Warwick journal or a New York journal. We've just chosen the best topologists and geometers we could find. And it's incredibly successful, and the standard's going to go up too. We're going to end up number one amongst all journals within 4 or 5 years, I reckon. Anyway, you don't want to hear about that. What you want to hear about is the technicalities of how we actually run the thing and why we're so cheap, at probably a tenth of the price of any Elsevier journal, and surviving. So Nicholas is going to tell us how we run it. And okay. I'll chat while he finds his PDF file.
Okay. Right, so I got involved in this sort of a few years ago. I did my PhD with Colin part-time while working as a computer programmer. And then my programming career, which had been getting increasingly stressful, on one sort of abruptly went up in flames and someone set fire to the company that I was working for at the time. The first thing I knew about it is when I couldn't log in on Monday morning, and this was because the computer no longer existed. And shortly after that, meanwhile I'd finished the PhD, and I'd been doing various bits of part-time work for Colin, and this kind of expanded. So I now work. I think it's probably about a third or a half of my working week is spent sort of working on a journal. So I'm going to sort of talk about the certain aspects of the LaTeX formatting that we do, and in particular I use a PDF LaTeX and a package called PinLabel which Colin wrote. Then I'll say something very briefly about how we coordinate this, because we currently have, I think, sort of three production editors working on Geometry and Topology and the other journal and the monograph series that we run from Warwick. And I'm based in Warwick, Richard is based in University College London, and Liz is in Stanford, in California. So it's important that we each know what the others are doing. And then I'm going to talk a bit about how we sort of publish articles on our website, and certain aspects of that, and then maybe just finish with a couple of comments about what I've got in mind for the future. To start with, we use sort of the traditional LaTeX, DBIPS, and then PS to PDF to produce the PDF versions of the papers. And we had a homegrown class file, which I think, was it you and Silvio?
No, I wrote it.
You wrote that one, okay.
Yeah, that was just basically Article class with a few tweaks.
Yeah.
And we also use plain text to begin with too. We allow plain text.
Yeah, I think that was about 3 years. 3 years in, I think we sort of stopped doing that.
No, it went for quite a while. It was about 4 or 5 years ago. About 2000 we stopped.
Okay. So now we sort of pretty much insist on LaTeX submissions. So that was until about a couple of years ago, and then in 2005, and this started with the founding of Mathematical Sciences Publishers, which grew out of Geometry and Topology publications, and which is based both at Warwick and at University of California, Berkeley. We had a bit of a redesign of the workflow and the class files. And so we have an underlying class file which basically takes care of the underlying metadata, which I'll talk about a bit later. And then each journal that we run has its own class file that incorporates this. And we have a public version of the class file that we make available and encourage the authors to use. I mentioned the metadata. So back in 1997 we had one journal, Geometry and Topology. And now we've got seven. The first three of these are run from Warwick, and the next four are run from Berkeley. And we've got at least one more currently in the planning stages. So it's really important to keep everything consistent. And one of the ways we've done this is to settle on sort of an underlying metadata standard. That all the journal sources follow. So, and by metadata I mean things like the author names and author addresses, the title, the publication date, the abstract, and so on. And in fact, here's an example of a typical. Well, actually, this is just a completely made up one, but it's an illustrative sort of example of the sort of thing that I mean. And so each LaTeX file will have something like this at the beginning, and then we use this to actually in the web publication scripts all read all the metadata out of this, and then we use that to construct the web page. So I think the next thing. Oh yes, okay. So one of the reasons that we switched over to using PDF LaTeX, PDF Tech. Is this sort of package called Microtype, which we've found tremendously useful. I don't know if anyone's, I guess probably most of you are probably familiar with this, but for those who aren't, this provides an interface to microtypographic extensions to PDF Tech. And in particular, it's useful for, if it kind of automatically, by means of microkerning and other clever tricks, it sort of helps minimise overfull H boxes. It minimises word breaking, and it sort of adjusts the interword spacing so that the overall look of the document is much tidier. So here I've got an example of some text that's not been typeset using this, and I think you can probably see that there's a couple of overfull H boxes here. This word here and this one, and then there's a couple of word breaks at the beginning there. So if we recompile this using the Microtype package, then it just adjusts the interword spacing. So we've lost those.
Could I just interject? It isn't actually the interword spacing that's adjusted. What Microtype does is it has a palette of slightly different sized fonts that it selects from,
okay.
And you can't see it. In fact, it looks better. The fonts actually look more uniform rather than less uniform. You wouldn't believe it, but on the right there are three or four or five different, microscopically different fonts. On the left, there's only one. But it knows what it's doing.
Hmm.
And it uses, if you look down the right-hand column there, apart from the overall H box, it doesn't look right, it doesn't look even. If you look down the right-hand column over there, it looks perfectly even, but it isn't. So this is, I mean, we're very enthusiastic about it. This is one reason why we are no longer using tech. PDF Tech is not tech, it's an extension of tech. But we're very enthusiastic about it.
And I think
it's made an enormous difference to the appearance.
And in most cases it's pretty much just a matter of putting use package
at
the beginning, and it has sensible defaults. This is something we're
very keen on.
The next thing, right. So I think I'm going to hand over to Colin now because this is.
Oh right. Okay. So yes, sir. Okay. Stand up.
The
page down. Yes.
Okay.
So one of the things that we decided when we were setting up the the latest format files was that we're going to have the graphics perfectly labelled using matching tech labels. And PDF tech has a disadvantage, well, not disadvantage, whatever it is, a feature, that it doesn't go via PS. A lot of the packages that we were using, RLEPS, that's one I wrote with Michael,
Michael
Green, and PSFrag, they actually use PostScript tricks, which don't work with PDF tech. So what we do now, oops, how do I go back? Yes. So what we do now is that we make the graphics file unlabeled, and then we superimpose the labels. And I've written using a package that Silvio Levy had, JompSpig, an overlay package, a package for doing the labels, which is called PinLabel. And PinLabel puts the label on the file, and it's very flexible. You can tell it to pin the label in lots of different places. So this is put as the label, and those points around there are labeled points. And if you here's the thing actually in action. This is the actual code to do it. Okay, so you open a label list. You can do any tech formatting you like. I'll come back to here in a minute. And then you type pin label, the label, at. And the coordinates you write there are ones that you've read using GhostView. Okay, if you ever play with GhostView, the position in the PostScript file comes up on the screen. And then, now this one here has got an L tag in there, which means that you're using the left-hand side of the box, B3 minus to pin it. That's been pinned top right. So when you're doing it, you actually put your cursor somewhere here to leave the label. You don't try and guess where the label is going to go. It automatically gets spaced. The reason why this label is in curly brackets is it's got spaces inside it. It can't, it uses spaces, the syntax uses spaces as separators. So it needs to know that that's all one label. And then that one's top, that one's right, and that's bottom left. And that one's right. And then the spacing is automatic. And if you change hair is the spacing. And if you change hair, you can see that the hair, the spacing just moves itself. There's also a fine adjustment where you can move them a tiny amount as well. Anyway, if you're interested, pin labels should be in all current distributions. It's on the CTAN servers. I didn't check that it was available on the CTAN servers, but okay. It should be there.
But certainly we can get people copies if it's...
Certainly, you can pick them up from our website.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so that's PinLabel.
Okay. another thing that we kind of needed to do, really. So when authors submit articles to us, the bibliography can be in any sort of format, really, and so usually it's in the form of a output from BibTeX using some sort of BibTeX style file. So basically, it's in BBL format, and often they either don't have any more, or they haven't given us the BibTeX source. So we need some way of sort of converting this into some standard form. So we have this script called BBL to BIB, which takes as the name suggests, it takes a BBL file and converts it into a BibTeX file. And it does this by means of a very useful web form on the American Mathematical Society website, where you can paste in some LaTeX or TeX code from a bibliography, and it will go and do its best to find the mathematical review entry pertaining to that article. So this is something that kind of, I don't know, it probably only really works for mathematics at the moment, but I guess if there's something similar that other disciplines have, then it could be converted to use that. And so this gives us a standard .bib file in return. And then we have another script called suck_url, which basically goes out and finds the URLs and sucks them into the bib file. And so this enables us to produce sort of a linked .bib in the journal style, because we then sort of feed this back through BibTeX. So here's an example. This is a completely artificial example, because it's a citation to one of my papers, and no one ever cites my papers. So perhaps you see that this is an artificial example.
If you publish this, you'll have a citation.
Well, yes, hooray. I should have put another one in as well. So this is basically some sort of typical bib item, and then we sort of feed that through BBL to bib and suck_url, and it gives us something like this. And so in particular, this ZBL number, this is the Zentralblatt Mathematics review database link. And then above that we have it's actually found the URL to the online version of this paper. And then we feed that back through BibTeX, and it'll give us something like this, and the blue things are actually hyperlinks. So this is something we sort of found quite useful. So as I said earlier, there's currently sort of three of us, three production editors in addition to Colin, sort of working on the Warwick-based journals, and we're all sort of dotted around the place. So and also in addition, we have the academic editors who, as you saw from the list earlier on, they're sort of scattered throughout the world, and individual referees and authors as well. We use email and sometimes Skype to communicate. We keep track of the production queue by means of a wiki that we have. We have our web server, and so anyone who sort of edits a paper or has got the proof corrections back, they'll make a note of this on the wiki. There's also something I think Paolo Ney de Souza, who is one of our Berkeley team. He and a couple of the others have developed this web-based workflow tool, which I've got a screenshot of on the next slide. Which I don't know. We're certainly it's being used for some of the journals, and I believe the American Mathematical Society have expressed an interest in using it for licensing it for all their journals. I think some of us use Subversion for revision control if there's more than one of us editing a file at a time. So this is the workflow tool. I don't know. But basically it's sort of it keeps track of the entire editorial life of any article, from the initial submission, through the refereeing process, through the production editing, the proofing, the web publication, and as far as the printing of the final volume. Sorry, you looked like you were about to ask a question.
No, I'm not.
Yes, it's something we haven't really been using for the Warwick-based journals yet, but the Berkeley-based journals all use this.
Well, that's a screenshot of a Warwick-based journal.
Oh, well, yes.
So it's been used
for
the first bit for the...
Yes. So we're sort of, I think we're kind of evaluating it at the moment at Warwick as well. So I think this is something that it basically keeps track of everything, and it automatically sends out email messages to referees. So maybe you can see there's a remind button there, and that's where the editor can click on that, and it'll sort of send an automatic reminder to say your paper's been accepted, but you haven't sent us the final source code yet, and that sort of thing. The web publication, right. As Carvey was saying earlier, I mean, we sort of try and automate this as much as possible, because I don't know. I mean, I can't be bothered to sort of to keep writing almost identical HTML pages. So obviously we um, anything we can do to automate the production of that is going to save time and effort. So we have a number of Perl scripts which use this phenomenally useful Perl module called LaTeX Tom, which it parses a LaTeX file and constructs an internal sort of parse tree in memory of this, and then you can actually go and sort of step through this parse tree by using the various functions provided by the module. And in particular, we use it for our Perl scripts use it for pulling out the metadata that I mentioned earlier from the LaTeX source file. And so we have scripts that automatically compile the PDF and give the file the correct name and put it in the right place on the web server. We have another one which generates the HTML abstract page, and this also uses the Tech4HT translation software. We have another script which updates the issue contents page, the author index, the RSS feed, and then we have other scripts. We have another script which generates the XML for registering a DOI. So I'll explain what a DOI is I think on the next slide. But basically, I just don't have time to write XML files, and we kind of wrote a script that does it and just pulls all the information it needs out of the source file. And this is really handy because it means we just have to keep track of as long as the LaTeX source file, the main LaTeX source file, is up to date and everything's correct in there, then everything else can just be synchronized with that by just running or rerunning these scripts. And then finally we have another script which generates a notification message for the subscriber mailing list. Okay, so I mentioned DOI. So this is something that we started doing a couple of years ago. A DOI it stands for Digital Object Identifier, and it's essentially a kind of a permanent URL with accompanying metadata. And you sort of register these by uploading correctly formatted XML to one of the registration agents that exists. And the one that deals with academic publication is called Crossref. And they've been running for a few years now. Most of the major publishers, I think probably all of the major publishers, are sort of subscribers to Crossref, and they register DOIs through their organisation. So the idea is that by registering one of these things, the publisher essentially agrees to keep this DOI, this sort of redirection, pointing at the current location of the object, which in our case is going to be a mathematical journal article. And so if we rearrange our website, then we have to update all of these by uploading sort of new versions of the XML files to the central repository. And then the idea is that any subscriber or any reader or anyone who wants to find this particular paper can go to this URL here, dx.doi.org/, and then followed by the DOI. And that will redirect to the current web page where you can find this article. So a DOI will sort of look like this, and the first thing before the slash is essentially that's unique to a given publisher, but the thing after the slash is up to the publisher to define, and we've gone for a fairly transparent sort of protocol here. So this one points to Algebraic and Geometric Topology, which is one of the wide-based journals, volume 7 in year 2007. Article starting at page 1409, and in fact, if you go to this, then it does an HTTP redirect to the actual location on our website, so this is something we found quite useful. I think most of the major publishers are sort of doing this sort of thing as well, so MathML. So the On the abstract pages for the articles, the Berkeley-based journals, they are using MathML abstracts for browsers that at least are believed to support it. Although I think at Warwick we're not at the moment. We're still sort of a bit unsure about this. And the reason I'm unsure about this is that this is what my browser does with MathML. And I'm doing something wrong. I've got something wrong here, but I've not managed to figure out what it is yet. So I think until it's stabilised, I think it's not something that maybe...
But if it's not my position, you should point out that that's nonsense.
Yes, this is gibberish. The actual words are correct, but the strange characters are nonsense. Possibly the...
So infinite is correct.
Yes. But,
I mean, that seems to be rendering the MathML, like the infinity.
Yeah.
See that, but there's a
font
missing.
It's just fonts missing.
Yeah. I know.
There's no agreed fonts. That's the problem.
But I've been unable to get hold of copies of the fonts at the time. My browser gives me a note saying you need these fonts, and I've spent a lot of time trying to track down these fonts, and I don't. My feeling is that I'm quite technical, and if I can't do it, I can't really expect someone else to. But I think this is going to change in the next year or so. I think it's almost there, and certainly the colleagues over in Berkeley, I think they've been experimenting with this. So I think it's something that we're going to sort out soon. But at the moment, you know, I don't think it's quite there yet. So this is why we're sort of not quite using it yet at Warwick. I think this is pretty much it. There's a couple of ideas that we've got in the pipeline. Sort of as soon as I can find time to actually implement them and experiment with them. So there's something that Crossref do in addition to the just redirecting to your web page. You can actually upload, in addition to just the ordinary sort of metadata like who wrote the article, where it was published, and what the title is, you can actually upload citation data as well. And then you can find out which articles, at least those published by a participating organisation, have cited any of the articles you've published. And this is something they call forward linking. I think it's something a number of publishers are doing. I think hopefully it's something that we'll get around to doing.
Is this a form of social networking?
Sort of. A very sort of academic very academic kind of social networking for journal articles. I'd never thought of it like that, but I suppose it is. Also, this is something that a lot of journals also do. They have an HTML formatted version, copy of the bibliography, included or linked from the abstract page. I've been experimenting with this recently, and I believe we can do it. I've written some scripts which, at least in principle, generate one of these from the article.bbl file. So hopefully this is something I'm going to implement in the next couple of months or so, if I can get around to it. And then there's another mad idea I had recently, which is that this is something that Amazon do. You can sort of say, okay, people who bought this book also read this. And I don't know whether this is something that anyone would want, but I don't know. It was just an idea I had, so it's something that if I get time I might sort of experiment with at some point.
You have it as a removable sidebar.
Yes. I think it's something that maybe we wouldn't put on the main abstract page, just have an unobtrusive link that people are interested. So I think that's kind of pretty much all I was going to say. Before we
sign off, there's one big topic we haven't mentioned, which is money.
Yes.
We started off being free. Of course, we're not free now because I can't pay Nicholas.
Yes.
But To give you some idea, the three Warwick-based journals we've been talking about publish about 5,000 or 6,000 pages, more 7,000 pages a year.
Mm-hmm.
We've got three part-time editors, about one full-time staff doing the whole of that.
Mm-hmm.
We can make a very comfortable profit, enough to pay all the overheads, with 150 subscriptions at 15 cents a page. So I mean, that compares with Elsevier's charges, which you know. So, and if you compare that with the figure that the previous speaker put up of 130 editors producing 170,000 pages, and that's not just the technical editors. I'm talking about everybody. So, we really are very, very much cheaper than the commercial publishers, and it's all because we're using open software, well, as much as possible, and because we've got all this automation, and because we ask the authors to produce good quality latex source, etc., etc., etc. We try and keep everything really, really tight. But the quality is not sacrificed. You look at any of our articles. Okay, that's all I want to say.
So how do you actually get your price? You charge people by the page, or you just...
Well,
rate?
We're charging by page at the moment. Well, it's a flat rate based on an estimate of the number of pages a year.
We say, well, okay, this journal published 2,500 papers last year, so assuming that we publish about the same next year, multiply that by 15 cents, and that's
the electronic, the library price, right?
Yeah.
Libraries are wicked. I mean, we started being open source, completely open. Libraries will not pay. They have a network. They know which things are free, and they tell each other not to subscribe. I mean, you know, they're completely cutting their noses off to spite their faces. All the good guys get cut off.
And they were saying very nice things about how...
Oh, it's wonderful. Yes, they're terribly supportive.
But their accountants were saying, oh, no, actually...
It's not a secret account. It's just that they have to cut every little corner, you see.
They have their own pressures.
So we had to go closed. Hopefully we'll open up again when we've got enough subscriptions.
I think the current year and the previous year's volume, I think, are closed. I think earlier than that is...
We open up after.
We're not
looking
for
it.
Have you sort of open access?
That's what we're saying. We can't be open access because libraries will not pay.
Open access generally charges at the back end.
No, we're not charging. It doesn't work in maths. Mathematicians don't have big grants to pay the page charges.
It works in
biology, and that's about it, basically.
I think this is very interesting that the open access has become synonymous with the author pays model, because it didn't used to be.
No.
I've listened to so many talks, I still don't understand, but you basically either you charge, and unless you're doing everything for free and people are doing it for free, which is fantastic, you would either charge people to read it or you charge people to publish.
Right.
So open access generally.
You charge people to publish.
You charge people or their institutions.
Yeah, the point is that model doesn't work in mathematics
because
mathematicians don't have, they're not all working on big grants. I mean, you don't charge the author can't pay, you charge his grant holder.
Correct.
So it works in somewhere like microbiology, where they're all being paid by big corporations, they've got the grants and the page charges are just a trivial little bit on top.
But
it works very
by
well.
The same token, that someone has to pay, they have to subscribe to it, and the libraries have to subscribe.
Oh yes, yes, the libraries pay.
It's coming
out of the university budget, yes, of course it's coming out of the university budget. It's just a question of how to distribute it fairly. And while you've got libraries telling each other where not to subscribe,
yes.
You know, PJM, the Pacific Journal of Mathematics, went open access for a short while. It didn't take long for them to just lose their subscription base. Warwick no longer subscribes, for instance.
Right.
They were told it's open access, you don't need to subscribe.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's one thing I've got to do is to chase them up to pay their subscription.
Oh, yes, something we haven't mentioned is that
on a related matter. One of the big benefits of taking a course at the Open University is that you get electronic access to the Open University Library.
Right.
And I believe that some people will say, oh, well, I'll take a course because it's worth it to get the library.
Yeah.
Does the Open University Library subscribe to geometry and topology? Can you?
I don't know.
Can you go through the Open University
Library? I very much hope so.
I bet they don't.
We should talk.
No geometers left, Colin.
Sorry?
No geometers left, I'm afraid.
What about topologists? Okay. You're one or two of those.
We don't have any names.
We've got some physicists.
I think we publish Pacific Journal of Mathematics.
Yes.
So this is, I think a couple of years ago, about 2 or 3 years ago, the owners of the Pacific Journal of Mathematics, which is a non-profit corporation, consortium of America and Pacific universities, they got in touch with us and said, okay, would you be prepared to not own, but to publish PJM for us? And I think they've been quite happy.
They've been very happy.
Yes. So that's something that's been quite successful.
Yes, you have.
Just a few quick comments. PS tricks. Firstly, really interesting things you're doing there. And on PS tricks, there is, you could try PDF tricks. My business partner, Radhakrishnan, he's written PDF tricks, basically.
What we prefer to do is,
you can do it in PDF tricks.
What we prefer to do is, if we can't write the PS tricks out, is to compile a PS file, make it an EPS file, and then incorporate that in a normal way. So we don't have a front end process for PS tricks.
And on the labelling of the graphics, have you come across Warm Reader?
Yes, it's horrible to use.
Okay.
I skipped that one.
It does a similar job though.
On the workflow tool that you were saying,
yes.
is that open source? Is that available?
No.
No,
you have to license it from us.
Something
from
know.
You?
Yes, from Mathematics Science Publishers, yes. That's our parent organisation.
I think I imagine it would be quite reasonable.
I don't
is that
know.
Something that you know we've been looking at? There's several things around.
Yes.
You know, commercial things, but we don't want to plug ourselves into something commercial.
No.
Well, why don't you write to Paul and Nate D'Souza? I'll give you the email address. It'd be very interesting licensing it.
He's quite evangelical about it.
Yes, he is.